Well, speaking about Machakos, like I told you, our team is currently on standby in Machakos County at the Salah Skills Center, where a lot of initiatives are being done by the young people when it comes to innovations around solar energy to recycling of resources. My colleague Joy Doreen Biira is pitching camp there. Let's now cross over to you, Joy. Tell us, what should you expect from Salah in Machakos?
Well, thanks a lot, Aby. There's quite a lot to expect here at the Skills Center in Malah, Machakos County. It is a small skills center, you know, just located on a 1.5-acre piece of land. But what happens here is that what makes the entire center unique are its green solutions to just about all of their operations. They're able to actually recycle some of their waste, and that is able to feed into their farm, which is just a few minutes away from where I'm seated. In my background, I'm sure you can see quite some busy gentlemen right there, and they actually are building solar lanterns right there. So we're going to be talking to them shortly, and not to mention this entire skills center is actually off the grid. They are able to produce 10 kilowatts of electricity right here. And we're talking about solar. So quite some interesting stories that we're going to be looking at here. But just to tell us about the Skills Center, we are joined by the director here, that is Jimmy Kilonzi. Good afternoon, and thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you for
having there's a lot of good things being said about the center,
yes.
And that is precisely why we're here. But talk to us about it. When did it begin, and
yes.
What exactly are your priorities as a center?
Thank you very much, Doreen. I'm Jimmy Kilonzi, the founder of the Skills Center. I began my work in 1997 in the slums of Mathare. And dealing with children and young people, I realized that we need to give practical hands-on skills mm-hmm. to these young guys so that they don't go knocking for employment, but they can use their own hands, their own skills to make a finished product and sell and have a living.
Yeah.
So Skill Center was constructed in 2011. I had a very fruitful cooperation with Technical University of Munich, Jomo Kenyatta University, and local workers. And we were able to put up a very green building, I would say, because the designing, the construction, the materials, everything looked into how we can be energy efficient.
Well, there seemed to have been a lot of planning put into it, because
yes.
when anyone gets here, the building is not as big as one would expect.
Mm-hmm.
But then again, when you look into the solutions that
yes.
you are providing and self-sustaining the entire building,
yes.
One actually thinks there are quite some extraordinary things happening here. So one of them happens to be solar,
yes.
self-sustained. Tell us a bit about that.
Yeah, we looked into definitely the kind of power needs that we have, the consumption needs we have in the house, because
mm-hmm.
we need clean energy for lighting and cooking. And you know, whether in the population in the slums or rural areas, as the population dynamics grow, also the consumption of energy increases. So green energy in terms of harnessing solar and using it for lighting and cooking was motivated by looking into the households where we have these young people coming from and making sure that they have a lighting solution that is environment friendly, health friendly, and one that is economically efficient also to them, going by the economic level.
All right.
Yes. So solar, definitely here we are looking at solar lanterns for lighting in the household.
Mm-hmm.
We are also looking at solar streetlight so that you can easily light your compound or even the streets in the slums or even your house, wherever it is. We are also looking at how efficient everybody can learn that using a solar lantern means eliminating all the effects that come with other unfriendly methods like kerosene, for instance.
Right.
Yes.
Okay, interesting. So before we even get into how exactly these solar lanterns are built,
yes.
The students that you have around here, last year you said you had about 90 students.
90 did the national exams.
And what skills do you equip them with?
We last year in December we had 90 students sit for national industrial trade test exams, and these were in solar photovoltaic, electrical wireman, motor vehicle mechanic,
mm-hmm.
carpentry, welding, hairdressing and beauty, dressmaking and tailoring. This year we have also begun baking and pastry, because young people more and more are produced from our education systems. Others are not able to complete. But here, we look at an opportunity for every one of them.
So
when
who
they come.
Qualifies? When you say you're looking at an opportunity for all of them,
yes.
And knowing that the Cabinet Secretary for Education, Fred Matiang'i, actually said about 40,000 yes. were not able to qualify to mm-hmm. get into higher institutions of learning, precisely universities. Mm-hmm. What does that mean for you, who is running a skills center such as this one?
Going by what is happening currently in this country, that every village polytechnic is turning into a university
yeah.
With collaborations with existing main universities, Skills Center is in an advantage position to offer the ultimate solution to these young people who are not able to transition to university or the intermediary high-level mm-hmm. colleges. So everyone else who feels I'm below the cutoff for university or any other middle college, this is a place to be.
All right.
The Skills Center.
Well, for most people who are actually below the cutoff points, they always tend to think that maybe they are the disadvantaged
yes.
In terms of academic performance. Mm. But is it exactly the case? The students that you have here today, is it that they were poor performers or is that their skills are in something else?
I would always tell you I have a mixture mm-hmm. of both well-performing in high school and also those who felt they were average or slightly below average.
Mm-hmm.
But the skills that we are offering here, trade tests, is 90% practical. The theory is just for you to understand the elements that you are using to fix a product.
Right.
But if you can lay your hands on a solar lantern and it lights a house and you sell and you have food, if you can lay your hands on a garment and turn it into a cloth and sell and you can feed yourself and your family,
mm-hmm.
this is a place to be.
All right. So very shortly, we're going to be crossing over to Ashley Mazuri, who is actually going to be showing us some of the skills
yes.
Being learned here at the Skills Center, which among them is how to build briquettes, among other skills. And so, Ashley, if you can hear me, what exactly are you doing on that side of yeah. the Skills Center?
Joy, on this side of the Skills Center, of course, I am here with Steve Ochieng, who is a student, has been a student in the Skills Center for 2 years. And of course, he's going to be telling us how exactly to make charcoal retorts, if I'm not wrong. And of course, he's also going to be telling us how to make briquettes. He's also going to be telling us the advantages and disadvantages of using this charcoal. Ochieng, sasa?
It's Sana.
So, Niambie, how exactly is this made? And let's start with, what is this?
This is the charcoal retort. Na uwe inatumika na kuni imekauka. So, tunahitaji fiberglass, tunahitaji a chimney, an L-shaped chimney. Hizo kuni pia tunahitaji. Na hii fiberglass ni ya kufanya ile heat yenye iko kwa hii chimney isitoke nje. Yeah, that's all I can explain for now. To begin lighting it, we come at the bottom of the tank where we see the shape. So at this hole is where we light it. So tukishaweka hapa moto, it will burn for around 30 to 40 minutes, then we leave it. Kisha chomeka, ile kuni imechomeka, ikachomeka. Then, kuna reaction. The reaction itakuwa ya, kuna reduction of carbon 4 oxide to carbon 2 oxide. Then, the carbon 2 oxide will again burn, go back through this pipe and go back there. Then it achomeka.
Okay.
It will also support the combustion. Okay. Then there's also the methane.
Mm-hmm.
Methane pia itasaidia kwa combustion when the CO2 and the steam
uh-huh.
from the woods.
Okay.
So the chemicals zinatoa methane, then supports the combustion.
Okay. So on the back of this, I can see the final product.
Yeah.
Initially, you told us that this charcoal and the charcoal that people are used to using is different. Can you briefly tell us the advantages?
These charcoals, they are light as compared to the normal ones. Mm-hmm. They are not so heavy.
Mm-hmm.
Secondly, mm-hmm. they burn for a long time. You can use them for at least, let's say, as this one mm. compared to the other one.
Yeah.
The same size. This one can burn for at least 4 to to 5 minutes, mm-hmm. While the other one burns for 2 minutes. Yes. So it's two times better than the normal one.
Okay. And let's talk about the briquettes, which you earlier told me. What exactly is the process and what is this? I can see a drum. What is this used for?
This one is used to make charcoal briquettes. Mm-hmm. We use them by burning grass or anything that is combustible. Mm-hmm. So these holes here are used for letting hair in. It's air. Uh-huh. Yeah. Na itumika kuleta hewa ndani. Uh-huh. Na pia huku chini pia kumetobolewa. Uh-huh. Ya kusaidia hewa iweze kuingia ndani. Uh-huh. So huwa tunaweka nyasi ndani. Uh-huh. Then tukishaweka nyasi hapa ndani, tunaichoma. Uh-huh. Tukishachoma inakuwa hii ndio product yake. Uh-huh. So from here, mm-hmm. we mix it with a binding agent. We can use, there are so many binding agents, but the readily available one is wheat flour. Mm-hmm. So we use wheat flour to bind it. Then later we take our mallet or hammer and our piston here. And our pistons. Mm-hmm. So we make them in any shape that we want.
So you put the matter here and you keep...
Yeah.
Okay.
So we put them inside. Then tunachukua mallet, kisha tunagonga, ili kutoa maji excess yenye iko ndani na kuipatia shape. So after hapo, kisha tunaiweka inakauka.
Okay. Finally, there's one interesting thing that I got to find out. Here is what they call a bulb, a bottle bulb. So what they use in this bottle bulb is basically putting water and bleach, and it can light up a whole room. If you can briefly tell us what exactly is this and what is it used for?
Hii hutumika ndio maji isiweze kuingia ndani. So ni silicone.
Okay.
So after cutting the iron sheet, mm. so unafaa kuweka silicone around ndio kukinyesha, mm-hmm. maji siweze kuingia ndani. Mm. So unafaa kuweka bleach na maji, kisha around una seal with the silicone.
Okay.
So maji siweze kuingia ndani, mm. kukinyesha.
Joy, as you can see, of course, here they use so much energy, but they make all this energy on their own. They harness their own charcoals and they make their own briquettes. And of course, the most interesting part of it all is that they make a bulb out of bottle and water and bleach. Joy.
Well, thanks a lot, Ashley, and some very impressive work being done out there. And I think this actually does send a message to the rest of our young Kenyans out there that you don't exactly have to get the skills that you need in the university. There are also vocational centers that are equipping our young people with the exact same skills or even more practical skills that they need to be able to make a living out of. Now, this very skills center is able to produce 10 kilowatts of solar power, and I would like to find out from the director Jimmy Kilonzi how exactly this is done. Yes. And maybe if you want to expound more on that, how did you even start to get into solar power production?
I think the beginning point was for us to do a unique building,
mm-hmm.
because a skill center providing a solution for young people who are unemployed and yeah. who actually do the largest composition of our population, we needed something unique, something to take the young people to the next level. And that would have begun with a green building where it is energy efficient, meaning we have to be off-grid, and our 10 kilowatt is able to power the machines in the welding, in the carpentry, mm-hmm. and light all the rooms that we have. We have, at a well sunny day, yeah. able to produce the entire 10 kilowatt.
All right. So do you use the entire 10 kilowatts?
Not
or
really.
You have a balance of about 6
we,
or 5?
We do have some balance of about 60-50%.
All right. And what do you use the 50-60% for?
For now, we have no particular use for yeah. the surplus that we have.
Yeah.
But Kenya Power, the rural electrification program, they were here 2 months ago, and we had a very interesting chat that actually we can connect to the grid
yeah.
and sell the surplus. When we produce excess, we connect to their line and they pay us by the end of the month.
All right, and so when we have is less this meant to start?
This is something that they have already put their lines.
Yeah.
We have already apostled on the compound. And I believe in the next 1 month, this should be finalized.
Impressive. I think that's one way to inspire the students as
correct.
Well. How many of them are interested in, say, electrical engineering or electrical wireman and welding as well? You know, how many of them are interested if you're going to give them a percentage?
Actually, if you look at our 90 students who completed last year, grade 3, 60% were electrical.
Yeah.
And we are trying to tell young people that as much as electrical may not have a very tiring involvement, there are also other better skills in Skills Center to involve yourself in.
All right.
So we have the biggest population interested in electrical wireman and solar photovoltaic.
Interesting. So as we look forward to getting that solar power on the Kenya power grid, we'd also now like to find out from the rest of the students. They also have electrical wiremen here at the Skills Center. And some of them actually learn how to build solar lanterns. And we'd like to now find out from them. Gentlemen, good afternoon. I would like to know your names.
Mervans Kimau. I'm a student at Skills Center. Basically, here we have a presentation on how to make a simple solar lantern.
All right.
Yeah.
Just before we come back to you, your names?
I'm Kennedy Kivulai, solar instructor.
A solar instructor. All right. So take us through the entire process. How exactly do we make a solar lantern? Imagine I am a student who doesn't know anything about what's happening over here and that my little electric skills are just as good as nothing. Take me through the entire process.
The solar lantern, we are making it using the locally available materials. It's just something that you'll find out there in the market.
Right.
So the first basic thing we need is a PVC pipe. It's 12 centimeters long and 10 centimeters diameter.
Yeah.
And then you need a fuse and a fuse holder. You need the jumper cables, jumper wire, a red and a blue one. This for positive, negative. Yeah, this is the negative,
right.
And this is the positive. Then you need a battery. You need a diode. You need a red LED.
What is this called again?
This is a diode.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is a red LED. You need a number of resistors. I have them here. There's a 2.2 resistor. There's a 1 kilowatt resistor.
This is 1 kilo.
1K, yeah, we call it 1K. 1 kilo resistor.
Yes,
yeah, we have that's 180.
Okay.
And this 560.
All right.
That's the number of resistors. You need white. We call it a white LED.
White LED.
Yeah, light emitting diode. This is what now you use as your bulb.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so when you have all of this put together...
And you have a switch.
Okay.
Yeah. And then when you put all this together, you make a simple solar lantern.
Yeah.
You have to make some holes to insert your switch. These, we call this an RCA.
Yes.
This is a female jack.
Yeah.
And then you make this connection. You make sure you connect your fuse. Then this, we call this the female jack. This for charging now the battery. And you need a panel. You need a panel.
Okay.
So that you can charge your battery.
All right. So this entire panel, is there something unique about it?
Nah, this panel, there's nothing unique about it. You just buy it and only that it comes with a pin so that you can charge your battery.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. So how exactly do you now connect the pieces?
To connect the pieces, you need a breadboard or a split board. This is now where you connect your resistors and the diodes and your jumper cables to so that to make the connection. And then to connect, you use a solder wire and a solder gun. We use a solder wire and a solder gun.
Right.
And You connect the resistors and the cables to have something like this.
Okay.
Yeah.
Now, all right, so
this is now the entire circuit.
Okay, if this is the entire circuit.
Yeah.
What exactly, how, you know, what's the finished product from all of this?
This is now part of the first step, mm-hmm. the first stage of the finished product.
You have to
ensure that it's working before you can now insert it there.
Oh, great.
Before you can insert it in the PVC, mm-hmm. you have to make sure it's working.
So that is after you've connected the negatives and the positives and pieced everything together.
Yeah.
When you power it, it actually lights up. Yeah. Let's try this.
Yeah.
Here we go. And it's quite bright. Would you be able to quantify how many kilowatts or kilovolts it could be? How many watts, actually?
It's about 40 watts.
40 watts.
Yeah.
This is 40 watts. And usually when we are powering a house, we use about 60 watts or maybe 70 watts, depending on just about how bright you want your lighting in the house. So 40 watts that we are looking at right here.
Yeah.
Let's cross over to our instructor here so he can tell us exactly how he works his magic on this side. Maybe if you could just hold the microphone right here. So tell us exactly your names again and what exactly this is all about.
Okay, I'm Kennedy Kivilai.
Yeah.
So after we have assembled those things, the resistors, the diode, so you come up with something like this.
Mm-hmm.
We have improvised these are the...
Mm-hmm.
So you have improvised these ones.
Yeah.
You can also find a way
mm-hmm.
where you can have this one
mm-hmm.
for the illuminance to be able to be seen.
Right.
So this one is different from...
This is different from?
From this one.
From that one.
Yeah.
Okay.
This one should be very different
mm-hmm.
in a dark room. This one should light a large area
mm-hmm.
compared to this one.
So how many watts are we looking at? Is it still 40 watts, 40 just
watts,
like the other one?
40 watts.
Ah, yeah. Okay. Yes. So this is just used for lighting up the house, nothing more.
Yes.
Maybe you can use it to
also, you can also charge your phone.
Yeah?
You use it to charge the phone.
Mm-hmm.
You insert this, the male RCA jack.
Yeah.
You insert it to the female.
Mm-hmm.
And then...
It
should charge.
Yeah, let's see.
Yeah,
yep,
and there it goes.
It's charging.
Yeah, it's right. charging.
So how many minutes of charge would it give me?
It can charge up to 5 phones. Yeah.
Up to 5 phones.
Yeah.
And that's for 40 watts.
Yeah, 40 watts.
Wow. All right. 40 watts charging 5 phones of this kind or any kind?
Any kind.
All right. There's quite a lot that we are learning from the skills center here. But as you can see, there's also what we call a street light on this other side. And I'd like to learn more about the street light, considering we have seen these bottles. Some of us who buy sodas sometimes are able to see bottles like this. So in just about a minute, tell us how exactly you put this together.
Okay. You just need to have a solar panel.
Yeah.
And you need to have a battery and a simple circuit.
Mm-hmm.
And then you just make your connection and maybe the LED.
Mm-hmm.
And we call this the heat sink.
Yes.
So this is just basically aluminium, which helps the bulb to cool.
Mm-hmm.
Because when it's lighting, it emits a lot of heat.
Yes.
So this just to help it cool.
So that is this that helps it cool.
No, these are metallic.
Oh, the one over
here.
Yeah, okay,
aluminium.
Great.
So this bottle is just like a bulb holder.
Mm-hmm.
And you can see we've put a big bottle so that it can emit light
right.
to a
large
area.
Are we able to
area.
Power it right now?
Yeah, it's
so
just...
So you can see how to
power it. To
power
it is just recover the solar panel.
Okay.
You avoid it from charging the battery.
Uh-huh.
And it lights.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So, say if I want to use it in my house,
yeah.
I want to use this. Sorry to say it's a street light. But if I want to use this in my house,
yeah.
do I just take off the piece of paper or whatever it is that I've used to cover
basically,
it?
Basically how it works, it's... It's an automatic. It has an automatic switch. When the sun rises, it will switch off.
Yeah.
And when the sun sets, now it will switch on.
So it's sensitive to day and night.
Yeah.
Interesting.
It's sensitive to sunlight.
So do you sell some of this stuff, or you're just doing it for practical purposes?
We've not yet gone commercial on this,
mm-hmm.
but maybe very soon we'll begin.
All right. Street light over here, a solar lantern, and just how to make these solar lanterns. And, these are some of the skills that they equip the students here. And it's quite interesting that these are skills that you wouldn't even get at the university, say, in your first year. So I'd now like to take a look at the other departments here, and one of them is welding. So I'm going to cross over to my colleague, Ashley Mazuri.
Joining me is Duncan Wangi, who's the principal of the Skill Center and also the welding and fabrication instructor. Of course, the welding department was brought into this school last year and it's new. So we're going to be finding out what exactly it's all about. Duncan, habari?
Nzuri sana.
So niambie, what is welding all about?
Okay, welding is an art. It is the art of joining metals using a suitable heat source. Probably electricity, but you know electricity can also be come from very many sources, and especially here in Skill Center, I found the school with an installation of 5 kilowatt solar power, and during 2016 we also added another second phase installation, which also gave us 5 kilowatt. Now we have 10. So that is what I use for welding.
Let's go back down to history. Of course, the school was started in 2011. Yeah, why did you take so long to start a welding department?
Okay, it took so long as I get it from the director of this institution. That is Jimmy Kilonzi. Okay, to find someone who can teach the trade, that is welding and fabrication, is not easy. Because those who graduate maybe in diploma courses or university, they find it difficult to teach in youth polytechnic. Yeah. So maybe it was difficult for him to get the teacher. Yeah.
So far, how many students have joined this class specifically?
Okay, being a new department, that is the welding and fabrication department, last year I had 4 students. They are the students who are able to sit there for their NITA exam. But right now, I have 2 students who came yesterday, and I'm waiting for more, because at least now, we did a good job last year, so, and we have also done an outreach program to make people know what we are doing, so I expect more students this year. Yeah.
So let's talk about what's happening here. Of course, I can see so many metals, I can see so many instruments that you guys use to do your welding. You can explain to us what exactly is going on here.
Yeah, right now, as you can see, I was working on sheet metal, this mild steel sheet metal. What I'm trying to fabricate is an energy-saving jiko, a skill center, or we call it a skill center wisdom jiko. So this is part of what the metals you are seeing around. We make products such as the energy-saving jiko. Yeah. And also we fabricate gates, we fabricate windows, we fabricate anything made of metal, including the roof here. When I enrolled in this school, we found that it's good that we can have a roof that is metallic. So we did it probably in June. Yeah, the roof above us, we fabricated ourselves. Yeah.
Before we go to the process of the smart jiko, of course, earlier on I was being told that the buildings were being designed specifically to harness energy. Can you tell us more about that?
Yeah, that's true. As you can see, our buildings are unique. This being a welding and fabrication workshop, you can see it is facing that direction, and also that roof is facing this direction. So that one to us is important, because here in Ukambani, since it is a flat land, so wind can come from many directions. So once the roof, one is slanting in this side and the other on that side, so that makes no wind that can come from many directions and put our roofs off. Yeah, again, if you look at the other building, they are slanting on the other side, and that is where we have now the solar panels. And you see, when for installation of solar panels, there is the inclination angle that is considered. So it is better on that side than this side. And again, the sun is available at least almost all day. Because if you see, if the panels were put on this roof, the sun will be available during maybe morning up to around noon. And then when the sun is on the other side, we cannot have this the solar irradiation. So that roof was specifically done that way for the solar panels.
Thank you very much. Of course, that's what you saw. The welding class, or rather the welding department, is coming up with different innovative ways to even save deforestation. Joy?
Well, thanks a lot, Ashley. And indeed, that is one amazing way to look at solving certain problems that we face, especially being a developing nation. There's quite a number of lessons that we can pick from the Skills Center here in Machakos County. As we wind up, Mr. Kilonzi, in say a line or two, what does your future look like?
I think the future is promising, especially mm-hmm. for this country, because yeah. the young people of this country, The future depends on them. And mm-hmm. if they can have practical hands-on skills, here we have the opportunity to turn around their lives. Mm-hmm. And this will be a sustainable way to make sure that the economic status of this country is based on the blue-collar opportunities that are there. And the hands-on skills is the way to go.
All right. There are quite a number of issues we haven't explored. One of them being the fact that they have a urine... What is it? A UDDT.
Diverted yeah? dry toilet.
Yes. This diverted dry toilet actually helps to feed into their farms around. And yes. so they're able to recycle some of their solid and liquid waste. Mm-hmm. And if you look around, you'll be able to see, you know, their farms that are growing pumpkins and tomatoes yeah. and sugar canes yes. as well as spinach that the students themselves are able to feed on. Well, we can't actually go any further than this, but we'd like to say thank you all so much for watching the show. We've been Thank coming you. To you live from Machakos County at the Skills Center that is located in Mala. My name is Joy Doreen Biira, and thanks to my colleague Aby Agina as well, who has been part of the show on the other side in studio, and Ashley Mazuri as well, that I have been with, and to the entire team as well that has helped to put this together. Thank you all so much. Coming up next is Worldview.